Well, if y'all want to join the hangout, I'm going to sit here and wait for some people to come in. But the link is in the chat room over to the right of the broadcast. I posted it now. I'm going to post it again in case it don't show up and you don't see it unless you're actually already in there when I posted it. But it's in there now. And you can actually join.
You don't see it unless you're actually already in there when I posted it, but it's in there now.
So anybody wants to come on in, let's chat for an hour because we're going to end this thing at 10 o'clock. I don't want to sit here and kill too much time. Because I do this live cast each day and I'm trying to work it around family time and work time, so we'll see how that works. Friday night I can see where it probably will work okay, but the one through Monday through Thursday is the one I might have to change eventually. Time will tell. I know summertime is going to probably throw a monkey wrench in the middle of it because working so late, but I'm gonna try to keep it the times I got, no matter where I'm at. If I can get on a Wi-Fi, whatever, instead of eating up my data, which broadcasting live on a phone will eat up your data real quick. To properly do this for like 15-20 minutes live broadcast on the phone for 15-20 minutes, like 4 or 5 days a week, you need like 50 gigs of data to be able to handle that. Hey, looky, we got somebody.
What's going on?
Hey, Eric, I do believe.
Yep.
All right. Hopefully we get some more people coming in.
Yep. We'll see. Usually everybody shows up once it's been going for like an hour or two.
Well, I'm going to stop it at 10 o'clock at 1 hour. Now, I'm not going to close the hangout because if I leave and somebody's still in there, the hangout keeps going, even if they want to talk to themselves.
All right.
But I'm just trying to keep it down to an hour. Just like my live broadcast I do during the week, I was going to do it for 15, probably try to keep it 15 minutes or less. I hadn't succeeded on that yet. It's been 30 minutes or more every time.
Yeah, well, the videos kind of choose their own running length, don't they?
Yeah, now, see, if I do like Zach does, get in my mind of what I want to talk about it, done. But see, I'm sitting there broadcasting and I got my laptop going and I can see the chat, so I interact with them, and next thing I know the time just whoop gone. Yeah. If I don't see the chat, then you know I just broadcast what I want to talk about and go.
He's always doing it from his phone, so I don't know how well you could see the chat. I've never tried to broadcast, especially from my phone.
Yeah, that's just it. He can't see the chat. And I broadcast from my phone as well, but I got my laptop open because I'm in my office or whatever. And I just start to interact with the people in the chat, and just time just goes right on by.
Yeah.
See, the ones I've done in my van, there was only like, you know, just 15 minutes or so because I couldn't see the chat.
I notice sometimes, I don't know, it's probably my phone. When I try to stream anybody's live stream on my phone, it can't keep up. But I can watch YouTube videos on my phone, so I don't know how that makes sense, being that it's essentially the same thing.
Do you watch the videos in HD?
I don't change any settings on my phone, and I have no problem watching YouTube videos, like long YouTube videos on my phone, and I don't have them ever buffer on there. So
you got 3G or 4G?
It depends where I'm at.
Like you said, it should be the same.
Yeah. It's just the mobile network. I guess like it just can't keep up.
Maybe.
Sometimes the video will buffer for like a second or two and then go. So I guess when I'm trying to do it live, it just can't keep up.
It might be that YouTube broadcasts live in a different format, frames per second or whatever, and that might hinder of what your data and all is.
It's possible.
I know when I watch Zach on my phone, sometimes it'll pause for about 2 or 3 seconds and then come right back. But like you said, when you watch a video, it works fine. But then again, when you're watching it, you're not watching it 100% live, accurate, you know, exactly when it is. It's a delay, so it might be a glitch in there of sending it out, and your data can't keep up with it. Now, if you're on a faster connection, it might be able to keep up on a computer and stuff. Now, when you watch a video on YouTube, it adapts to whatever your best connection is. So it might drop the bit rate on it. Like if you watch it on a computer, it might be 720, but if you watch it on a cell phone, it can drop it down to 360p.
I've even had my computer drop that low before when my internet was having issues, but not usually. I can't try to watch in there's some of those videos that come out there in the new 4K HD, and my computer or my internet connection, or probably the combination thereof, can't keep up.
Oh, you mean the 720 and the 1080p with the 60 frames per second?
There's something higher than that. It's called 4K HD when you're in the YouTube settings now. It's even higher than the 1080p.
Yeah, they're going up to 60 frames per second. And then it's the 20-something P, which is the 4K.
Yeah, the 4K I can't do.
Yeah. But you don't need, you know, if you got a 30-inch screen TV, you put 720, 1080p or anything higher, it's not going to look any better.
Mm-hmm.
Because 720 is good for up to like a 40-inch TV. Then if you get anything above that, you need to go up to 60-inch, you can get 1080p. And anything above that, you need, you know, 4K to really get the quality out of it.
I've noticed I can see a significant difference even on my laptop screen, which is probably a 13 or 15. No, it's probably a 13. I don't know if the laptop screen just has more resolution, but
yeah, it might be a high definition liquid crystal screen. If it is, then you will see a difference, but only maybe 30% of laptops or desktop screens are even that way.
Yeah, this is not an expensive computer, but I can definitely see the difference when I switch to the 4K videos. It's very noticeable, but who knows? I'm just glad to be home, man. I spent almost 11 hours today in an attic. Not fun.
That's fun.
No. I'm too tall to be in an attic.
Yeah. Yeah, I was in an attic today changing an evaporator coil, trying to beat the rain. It got me for the last 45 minutes to an hour.
Keep those... whatchamacallit, those CVT ports on your truck. So when you're working in the rain, just put them in at the indoor unit and vacuum and charge inside.
Yeah, I just didn't want to carry it all the way upstairs and then carry it up in the attic.
Yeah.
Well, actually, I could do that because when I change the coil out, it actually has a port on there for a TXV.
Yeah.
So could have done it, but it just not. It wasn't a lot of room up there either. But I got it done, but it wasn't easy. But trying to beat that rain. I ran it in air conditioning because it was so freaking cold. I couldn't get the gas to go in.
Use the recovery machine and push it in.
No, what I do is take the service valve, the shutoff valve on the low side, and turn it off. And in the heat, the low side heat port, I put it right there, and it sucks it right in. They don't have no choice because there's nothing else for it to suck on.
Yep.
I just crack it open a little bit. When I need more, I just crank that down a little bit, like I'm going to do a pump down, so it will pull out of the tank.
It's funny because I looked up before. They make tank heaters, and they're ridiculously expensive. If you get a little electric blanket from Walmart, or like a heating pad for your back. Get one of those and wrap it around the cylinder. You really push it out.
Oh, I used to get a crankcase heater and wrap around it and plug it in and let it sit for about 5-10 minutes and heat up the tank.
Yeah, that works good too.
Mm-hmm. I just put my gauges on it and keep an eye on it, and I can tell when it's enough. When I get it up to about 125, I know that's more than enough to push it on the low side.
I've used MAP gas, but I don't recommend that to anybody.
Yeah.
Not that I need to do that much. I mean, I'm running in cooling today as it is.
Now, sometimes I'll take the tank on the way there if it's a long distance and sit it in my front seat of the van and turn the vents right on it and just crank up the heat.
There you go.
Warm me and the tanks up real quick.
Yeah, I don't have to do much in the cold weather. Like I said, man, the other day? Was it Monday? Monday, my first snow heat call of the year. Hmm. And by the afternoon, it was in the 70s again, so nobody's using it.
So to use it for an hour.
Yeah, there's hardly even heat pumps down here. I was looking at one the other day. Actually, it was funny that day because I had I looked at 4 units that were either no heat or having problems in heat, and there was a heat pump, and I'm running it in heat mode, and the problem was, and I got to post the video. I got it on my phone. I got some video. They're using 2 3-ton water source units, and they had them wired to 1 thermostat, and they were 2 units, and they took the circuit boards out, so they were wiring all the pressure controls and the float switches on red. So the thermostat would go blank because the unit was going into high pressure. And it had low airflow and heating. I'm looking at it. I'm like, I'm running it cool. It's running fine. Then I turn it to heat, and the head pressure is going up to like 360, and suction pressure is at 80 on R22. And I'm like, scratching my head for a second. What's going on here? Because I'm not even used to watching a heat pump run in reverse cycle. And I'm like, oh, it's got to be airflow. So they had the second unit that was powered off of it. It wasn't, they broke the contactor with the float switches and pressure controls, but the first unit they broke red, so I changed it to break compressor contactor, and that way, as long as one of the units run, as long as, you know, they'll just cut out on pressure and come back, because there's nothing I can do for it. Yeah. It was a very weird setup.
I had one last week. Somebody called me to do a second opinion evaluation of what's, Dynox, what's wrong with the system. And I asked him, I said, what were you told before? Well, I had one company tell me that it was the compressor. I said, is that all? Yeah, that's the only one I got. And you're the second one. I want to come out and give me a diagnose of what it is. I said, okay. So the first thing I did, I went over to the unit just to see, because most of the time you'll get, the other company actually know at least a little bit of what they're talking about.
Yeah.
At least you want to think they do. So I went to the outdoor unit.
You pushed the contactor and it ran?
I didn't even get that far. They said they have no heat. So I set my bag. It was kind of raining and all a little bit. So I set my bag on top of the unit so I can open up and lay it real good. And I got my drill together and all that good stuff. And I just happened to look down there, looked at the thermostat wire. Something kind of looked odd. Real small thermostat wire. And more I investigated before I even opened it up, it was a two-conductor. Do you know the rest of the story?
Nothing to energize the reversing valve?
Yeah, because it was a straight air unit.
Oh, it wasn't a heat pump?
No, it was a straight air, and the daggone furnace was in the attic.
So, the compressor, how did they diagnose a bad compressor?
Well, I talked to the customer. They said it has to be a bad compressor because when they turn the heat on, the outside unit's not coming on.
Okay. There's more steps to it than that. Even if your compressor doesn't start, you still have to make sure your wiring's good to the compressor and you're getting power to it. Or
yeah, that's what you know. That's what I know, but I thought they were joking at first. They said, no, that's what we were told. I said, okay. I said, did they go up in the attic? No. They just went outside.
They didn't do anything. They looked from their truck and said, let's try to sell them a new unit.
Mm-hmm.
Your compressor's bad. $900 to change the compressor or we'll change the whole unit. We don't recommend you change the compressor. See that all the time.
Yeah, a lot of them out there, they really don't want to work on them. They just want to change the suckers out and go on to the next one.
More money to change it out.
Yep.
Me, I'd rather fix them because that's what I like to do. But yeah, when it does get to that point, it is sometimes better to change out the unit, but it has to actually be broken, you know? I'm not just going to go to every unit I see and say, bad compressor, bad compressor, bad compressor.
Yeah, that's about like saying, man, I got a flat tire. I guess I have to buy a new car.
It's not that, you know. Not that.
Well, I've seen it where it was nothing but a capacitor. And.
Well, know. Yeah. That's a different story, but it's your capacitor's bad, you need a new AC. That's not okay.
Exactly. That's also what I'm saying. I got a flat tire, I need a whole new car.
Yeah, that
that's about the same sense it makes. It's just I don't know, it just they out there. I don't know if it's because they make money on commission or it's just they just drill in their head, sell, 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 sell. I don't know.
Well, if you're not smart enough to fix the problem, you can easily sell them a new equipment, and then, you know, usually that fixes everything that was wrong with the old one.
Yeah. And you probably never see the customer again.
Although, my buddy told me that I used to work with that he went behind one of their service guys who diagnosed the unit as bad and they went and replaced it. And he was sent behind the guy to replace the unit. They put the new unit in, didn't run. Bad thermostat. The guy sold him a new system for a bad thermostat. And they bought it.
Wow.
And a guy just, I know the guy, he just doesn't know what he's doing. He really is that bad, but you know. Those type of people, they sell lots of equipment if you know how to talk to people.
Yeah, and it's a shame that they do that because the customer is the one that gets hurt.
A lot of times they don't even know it. They bought a whole new unit.
Yeah. It's a shame that that happens. You see that video that Zach put up earlier?
Which one?
One about that where the compressor would not run the outdoor fan motor was locked up.
I didn't watch any. I worked so late today, I didn't watch any. After I got off work, I didn't want to watch any more HVAC videos. I was just like, I'm done.
I hear you. Yeah, he had one. It was outdoor fan motor was locked. He grabbed it by hand and tried to spin it. Wouldn't go. Your pressure, you put a hard start on it, and all it wouldn't do nothing but hum.
It's because it didn't know the words.
Yeah, and the capacitor was, I do believe you said the capacitor was wired improperly.
That'll do it.
I think he said something like had a, it was wired like the outdoor fan motor was on the 45 on the capacitor itself.
I think what was it? Gray Furnace Man did a video where he took a motor and he kept putting bigger and bigger capacitors on it and showing you like the starting torque that it would have. It was pretty cool. But after you got like a couple sizes too big, the starting torque just started going down and down and down. And then I've seen a unit before too where the capacitor, where a dual cap was wired wrong and the condenser fan was running backwards.
Yeah.
And weren't we actually, I think we were talking about that in the last chat too, of trying to make a compressor run backwards, a single phase recip.
Yeah.
And I ended up actually taking that compressor apart and finding one of the valves cracked. I have a video on it.
We got a lot of people watching, but nobody wants to come in.
Oh, I didn't go to the. Oh,
I see. They're hanging out in the chat room.
Yeah, I'm back in the. I'm looking at the chat now. Talking about buying wire at Home Depot.
Fox asked, how do we charge for second opinions? We just charge 1 hour labor just to come out.
Yeah,
that's pretty much a diagnostic fee. Instead of charging a full hour just to come out, look at it, usually we do like a 75, just a little bit lower than our normal rates.
That's basically how all our service calls start, is a $75 fee for coming out and looking at the equipment, and usually everything goes to a flat rate repair as far as residential. Usually. Doesn't cover everything, but, you know, like motors, capacitors, contactors, it's all just a flat rate from there because you're out of there within that hour. But if it's a coil cleaning, it varies.
Yeah, a lot of people, you know, they like people advertise for free estimates or what stuff like that. Yeah, I can give a free estimate over the phone. But if I'm coming out, if that van cranks up and rolls, dollar signs start to add up.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, overhead.
Yeah, if it rolls, somebody's bankroll, you know, bankroll is going to roll too because, you know.
Some people look at it as advertising, though, you know. They'll send a guy out there, and they'll try to push that guy to sell you something, you know. A lot of these, it's like a lot of these people who offer the, you know, we'll have around here $29.95, tune up your AC up to 1 pound of Freon, and then it has a little asterisk by it, you know. And then there's all these terms and conditions at the bottom. And,
no,
you
know, just tell them
advertising.
Yeah, now I do tell them if our company does the work, we'll give some of that back or all of it back or whatever, you know, depends on what the repair is. We can, you know, flush it away on the repair.
Yeah, it depends. I know my boss does that with some people. Like, if we go out and your unit's dead, we're not going to charge you. If you go with us to replace it, we're not going to charge you for that call to come out and say your unit's
right.
dead.
Yeah, usually if it's like a compressor, something major, we just do away with it completely.
Well, that depends. If they have you do the repair, but if they have somebody else do it, I mean.
Then they get charged.
Yeah, exactly.
If I can go to a house, I charge $75 to go there, and it's a capacitor. I say I can change the capacitor right now, and it will be a capacitor and $95. The $75 won't be there. But if I leave and have to come back, you're going to be charged that $75 before I leave. Because it's not a reinsure that I'm actually going – they're going to call me back to actually do the work.
Yeah, exactly.
Pretty much you just have to read the people and see what they're going to do. I had one lately, just this week. I had a HD TV antenna system to put in a house, and I'm supposed to wire three rooms. Put the antenna up, wire three rooms, it all worked fine. But the guy that I hired, he slipped up in the attic and put his foot through the ceiling. So I hired somebody to do the repair. It just happened that the owner of the house that I was doing the work for knew the guy that I hired. And when I got finished doing the work and checked everything, she said, well, I don't feel safe paying you until the ceiling's work. And up to that point, I hadn't even asked for payment yet because I wasn't going to until the sheetrock was done, which was going to be the very next day. Then the sheetrock got done, and then she called and said, okay, the sheetrock's done. It looks great. And she says, want me to go ahead and pay the guy that done the sheetrock? I'm like, she says, she was going to pay me cash. So she was going to take the cash and pay him for the work. I'm like, no. You and I got a contract. You pay me, then I pay him. It don't work that way.
Did she take issue with that, or was that the end of it?
Oh, she tried to. I said, no, you and I had a contract. You pay me. Him and I had a contract. I pay him. Rather or not I pay him or not pay him has nothing to do with the contract you and I have. I don't care if it's your brother or sister. She said, well, I would love to recommend you and all that, but I wouldn't feel right if you don't pay him. I said, ma'am, it's not relevant if I pay him or not, if I've done good work for you or not. There was no contract between you and him. And I said, just let me know when I can come and get my payment. And the very next day, I went over there at 6 o'clock, and I went and picked it up, and she paid me cash. Then she called me the very next day and said, have you got up with Mr. X to pay him? I said, no, I have not. I said, he hadn't returned my call or my text. So, well, let me know. I'm like, yeah, I'm thinking to myself, yeah, I'm going to pay him and then call you and tell you that that I've paid him. You don't have nothing to do with her. I'm like,
yeah, it's an odd situation.
Yeah, and I was going to, and she would sound like, oh. See, he quoted me $250. Then after he went over there and they got talking and everything, then it went up to $300. No, that ain't gonna happen. You quoted me top $250. You don't go up. You can't go up but 10% anyway.
Somebody's got a lot of background noise there.
Yeah, I'm trying to figure out what news that is.
What's going on, Barry?
Not much. How about you?
I don't know where the background is.
Who is that coming from?
I'm trying to find that out.
We're working with 25 inches with the design that we chose.
But Barry, is that you? Do you have a TV going in the background?
Yeah, give me just a second here.
Okay. You might have to switch to a different room. It was Barry. He's gonna address that. He said.
Yeah, I just noticed I can mute anybody, but it won't let me unmute anybody. Huh.
It should let you.
It's not. I just Duck was there. I muted him, thought that was coming from him, but there was no unmute available.
He's unmuted now.
Yeah, but that's because he did it. He had to do it because I didn't have no option.
His is echoing a little bit.
Yeah. He's listening to the live broadcast. Somebody is.
Well, a lot of times, like, I have headphones in because if I don't, my computer, the speakers and the mic will cause it to echo unless I turn my volume down. So, Lucas, you want to try turning your volume down just a little? Let's see. Yeah, that's better. There we go. Yeah, that's why I've been using the headphones, because the mics just pick up like crazy. So Greg's still muted. Greg, you can unmute yourself, and Barry, you can too when you fix that background noise.
But it won't let me unmute anybody. Huh. It should.
Hey, Greg, can you mute the YouTube video, please?
Coming from him,
yeah.
But there was no unmute.
Yeah, we were hearing that's great. We were hearing what we just said 5 seconds ago because of the broadcast delay.
Sorry about that, guys.
No problem. I guess I better check the chat again. So I guess people followed my advice and joined the chat. So who do we got here? You guys are both in the chat. I guess Barry is obviously Barry. Greg, are you Fox Family Heating and Air?
Yes, sir.
All right, cool.
Yeah, I had two calls today. I did a maintenance, and so it was one of those Groupons. I offered a furnace tune-up on a Groupon, and so the guy called me out. But he was a guy I referee hockey also on the side, and so he knew me from refereeing and. Bought the Groupon, went out and did the maintenance, ended up spending a couple hours out there, but we went over a lot of stuff. He had like a 18-year-old train gas furnace, just moved into the house this year, so a lot of potential, a lot of things going with that house.
Yeah, that furnace got some age to it.
Yeah.
Looks like Barry got his background noise taken care of. Looks like you switched rooms.
I did.
All right. Much better. It's still funny to me. Everybody's doing the no heat calls. I'm doing no cool stuff still this time of year. I've been telling my boss the other day, and I need to keep an eye out for it too, to get some training on gas equipment. Even though there's hardly any of it around here, I would like to expand my knowledge.
Really?
There's hardly even heat pumps. I'm in South Florida. I mean, it's like 72 outside right now.
Oh yeah.
I wish it was 72 here.
So you hardly ever see, you mainly see gas packs on restaurants, and they only bought them because they enticed the gas company to bring them a gas line for free, and they just never actually use their heat anyway. So, I mean, you almost never see a furnace. Hmm. Boilers are around, but they're about the same as the gas packs. They're almost never used. You'll see them more at like a hospital or you know, somewhere that they just have them for the CYA factor. They don't even use it.
Yeah, even for heating, I'm used to gas furnaces and heat pumps, but since I opened my business, I have done a lot more wall heaters, and I know there's not a lot to them, but I don't know, it's a new challenge that I'm taking up. I watched some videos and learned some stuff from you guys and figure it out.
Justin saying we're gearing for a big snowstorm here. I wish it was 70 degrees.
I wish it was 70 degrees here.
Yeah. Well, just all you gotta do is pick up and move, right? No big deal. Uh-oh, looks like Mike muted himself. So yes. Where are you all at? Where are you out of, Greg?
I'm in Sacramento, Northern California. So
okay.
We're experiencing the El Nino out here, and it's definitely getting a lot of rain. And so even though it's not super cold out, a lot of the older folks tend to still need their heating. So you get a couple calls every day.
Yeah.
What are you guys?
Interesting. Where are you at, Lucas?
Birmingham, Alabama.
Alabama.
It snowed today. A little bit.
Really?
Hell yeah.
And where are you, whereabouts are you, Barry?
I'm in a town called Hiram, Georgia, probably 25 miles outside of Atlanta. And okay. We're having some flurries today and predicting another... we don't call it snowmageddon, it's icemageddon here in my area, so waiting to see what's going to happen tonight and through the morning.
Nice. Huh. We've got a pretty good spread of people, but nobody north of the Mason-Dixon line right now. Justin is still in the chat, and he's not joining the hangout, I guess. I guess he doesn't want to be in here with us. I think he's in New Jersey, right? I think so, if I remember correctly.
Justin Henning?
Yeah.
Oh, I think he's in New York.
New York?
I'm not sure.
Okay.
I'm not sure. Yeah. I've subscribed to him.
Yeah, I'm originally from Pennsylvania, but I don't like the cold, so I moved as far south as I could.
I'm originally from Buffalo, New York.
Yeah,
it's always cold up there.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. I got enough of shoveling snow in my younger days, and I'm just like, I'm not doing this anymore. Let's move south. But I will be right back.
Mike, are you muted? Oh, okay.
Yeah, I was sitting and just listening to y'all talk a little bit.
You're the leader, man. We got to hear from you.
Well, you heard from me. Now I'm going to mute myself again. No, I'm going through the chat room and putting links in there where people can actually join and stuff.
Mm-hmm. I think everybody is in here except for Justin.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he said I think he said something about he was watching his son, daughter, or something. I think he's put something in there like that. Said. Yeah, 5-year-old son and a 10-month-old daughter.
Ah, man.
What are y'all's plans for the weekends? Anybody got work lined up or everybody have off?
I'm taking a day, weekend off.
Yeah.
I got my home advisor turned off and I ain't turning it back on until Monday.
What's home advisor?
It's a business that you sign up for and like somebody... And you sign up and you put in the areas that you want service from, and anybody in that area goes on that website and requests service, and happen that the service they want is yours, there's a chance you're going to get a lead for that customer. It will send you information saying this customer needs your service. It sends out, it picks 4 people or 4 companies in that area that signed up for that zip code or whatever. It will send it out to 4 of them, and then them 4 can call that customer, and then the customer can pick who they want.
It makes you call the customer, though, and doesn't tell the customer to call you?
They have a choice. They can punch that in, and it will list 4 on their screen. And also, it will contact companies as well and give them the choice to call that customer or not.
Yeah, I do a lot of home advisor, my call today, my Walfurnace call today came from home advisor, and I'm always trying to be the first one to call back, and I usually have my phone right by me, so I just call. So that lead cost me $18 for the lead, and 4 or 5 other guys got charged $18 also, whether they got the job or not. So that's kind of the downfall. If you don't get the lead, it kind of blows.
I just got somebody else come in. But yeah, it does have a downfall if you don't get the lead, but the key thing is be the first to call.
Exactly.
And I got mine set up where when somebody requests service and if it sends out to my company, I will get a text message, email, it comes through the app, and also Home Advisor program service will call me as well. So I get it 4 different ways on every lead.
You should just have it set up so it auto-dials them and have a Bluetooth headset in.
Well, when it calls me, it says you have a new lead, and it reads out their name, their phone number, and what service they are requesting, and it says please press 1 to be connected to the customer. I'm pushing that 1 button to my finger goes through my phone.
Right.
Or if I get the text first, now, it don't come in certain order, them 4 ways that I get. Sometimes I get a text first. Sometimes I get an email first because I got all that set up on my phone. As soon as I get that notification, I'm going straight to the app, see the notification, push 1 button, which says dial or call, actually, I think it is, and it calls direct. And then when I'm calling them, I'll click on another button in the app. It says map, and it will show me on a map, Google map, where it's located, and I can know exactly how long it will take me to get there before they even answer the phone.
Hmm.
It must be awkward, though, when you're the second, third, or fourth guy calling, and they're like, no, I already got somebody.
Yeah, it is awkward.
Yeah, I've had one that I called, I emailed, never heard anything from that customer for a week. So I took that lead and said, close, did not win the lead.
Right.
3 days later, they call me on my business line and says, I see that you are one that we were paired up with, and we got a message from you and all, but we just never called you back, and we'd like for you to come out. I went out, gave them an estimate of what it was. I went back the next day and repaired it.
Yep.
And you never know. I mean, yeah, it costs from $9 all the way up to $25.
Yeah.
Depends on if it's a direct lead or something in that category, it's not cost that much. But overall, it's worth it for me.
Today I got an exact match. So somebody went and saw my profile and then clicked on my page and said they wanted me personally. That cost me $28 for that lead.
Yeah,
and it's fine. But the thing was, they wanted some commercial work done, and I don't do commercial. So anyways, I put in a request for credit on that Home Advisor because it didn't match up with my profile. So hopefully, I get that $30 back.
Do you advertise? You do commercial in the listings on Home Advisor that you do commercial?
No.
Then you will get it back. If it's not listed under your profile that you do that work, that's all they do is check that. This is commercial. You don't advertise commercial credit. That's as simple as that.
Why do you not do commercial, though?
Huh? I've always done resi, you know, and that's all I've done. So I just don't have the experience. You know what it is that three-phase gets me, man. I don't really have any experience with it, so...
It's not a big deal, really. I mean, a lot of the stuff you run into in commercial is just residential units installed in a commercial space, like 9 times out of 10.
Right.
I went to a three-phase unit one time and had dual compressors in it, and I was just supposed to check it, you know, the service. So I checked the voltage and whatnot, then I came to the second compressor and checked the voltage, and I'm getting 240. I'm like, well, what's going on? But it was running. It would run. I'm like, okay. Scratched my head a little bit. I looked at the other one. Then I realized somebody put a different compressor in there, and then I traced the wire, and I saw the 45 capacitor up there.
They put a single-phase compressor in it?
Yep.
Yeah, you see that a lot.
Yeah. But
it's really not that big a deal.
No, it's just I've done it before because that compressor that was supposed to go in there was not available until maybe like 2 weeks, but they needed air condition. I said, well, I can do this, and it'll work just as good as long as I match the BTUs and stuff.
And just won't be as efficient.
I said, it'll cool you. So, and it was like something, say it was like a 54, and I put it like a 58 or 59 BTU in there just to get that little extra. And it works fine. It keeps them right at the same temperature in there, right in the middle of the summer. So,
yep.
As long as you can match it up and everything, technically and mechanically and all, you're all good. But it's a restaurant, and they couldn't wait for 2 weeks.
I'm surprised it was that far out just to get what was it, like a 3-ton unit? Is that why?
It was a small. It was a 4-ton.
4-ton.
4-ton rooftop, yep.
Yeah, you'd still think you could get those. I mean, when it gets to be like 3-ton, 3-phase, they start to take a while to get, but still. Yeah.
Are you guys just techs, or do any of you guys own your own business?
Mike owns his own business, Palace.
Yeah.
I think anybody else in here own their own business?
I mean, I do, but
MI Heating Guy, is your mic working this time?
Huh?
I was trying to talk to MI Heating Guy, see if he...
Oh, he says no.
No. I have the YouTube chat up. I don't have the Google chat up right now. I should probably pull that one up, too.
Yeah, I need to look at the other one on the live broadcast.
It hasn't gone anywhere. Not really. Actually, maybe...
Yeah, the service. Justin says the service guy that's on call, he's not gonna make much overtime because he will be snowed in.
Oh well, I'm on call. I'm on call until Wednesday, and I got all the call. I got everything being forwarded directly to my phone, so that was fun. Getting all these stupid telemarketer calls. This is your local Google representative, such and such, about your business.
Oh, hey, there I am.
There he is.
I'm just getting used to all this.
Me too.
Now, when you take your own call, do you get on call pay, or are you only paid when you have to go out?
I get 2 hours standby time on the weekends, and I get 1 hour on the weekdays.
Okay.
It's okay. part of our agreement. Pretty much how it works. Anything on the weekend is overtime, no matter what. Anything that's not within 8 to 4:30 is overtime.
Okay. Well, I work for a big box store doing maintenance work. They've changed all hours, you know, over the years. Everybody's cut back, changed the way they did things. If you go out, if it's 30 minutes, you get 4 hours. Of course, if you work four, you get paid for four. If you're gone 10, you get paid for the 10. We don't do an on-call pay anymore. We would kind of do the same thing. You would get paid a standard 1 hour a day during the week, two on the weekend if you so took it. And, you know, a lot of the guys would do the thing. They'd say they wanted to be on call and they'd get a phone call. Well, I've had a few beers or, you know, done whatever. Of course, you can't go out. And they just go down the list and send you. So, yeah, it works pretty good. But, you know, I was always one of the ones, you know, I'll go.
Yeah. We don't usually, people don't want to pay because it's a higher rate for Saturday and it's even higher for Sunday. People usually don't want to pay unless they're commercial. And a lot of our commercial accounts have maintenance agreements that don't break down.
Right.
So that's usually how it goes. You tell people, you know, because Sunday it's $150 just to go out and just to show up. So people usually wait till Monday where it's $75 again.
Exactly.
Saturday's $125. And anything after hours.
Well, and you know, with what you do, it is good. A lot of things that really aren't an emergency, they can make themselves comfortable and wait till Monday morning or whatever.
Or we have people that'll just call you out for nothing because they have more money than they know what to do with, but you know, those typically aren't the majority of people.
Right.
We take care of one house. They have 35 water source heat pumps in their house. This is a residential. But that they're on a monthly maintenance. They never go down. There's, I mean, if you don't catch it on the monthly maintenance, it's just, it's, we, I don't think anything's ever gone down there. We got a spare motor for the pump and a spare motor for the cooling tower there, so even if it did go down, you wouldn't be, like, scrambling to find parts. It must be nice to be them, though, right? I get freaking lost in that place. I mean, you just try to find your way around. I don't know how they do it.
It's just more to clean.
It's their Florida home. They're down here 2 weeks out of the year.
Wow.
They live in Iowa the rest of the time. This is their little house. I imagine that's a good little maintenance, though. It takes two guys one whole day. So it's basically, you know, 16 hours to do the maintenance there.
Hmm. What's all these Google effects you can put on yourself? I put a halo on myself over here.
See? Yeah, I saw one guy one time. He had a, I don't know if he had to download it. I think we discussed this a little bit last time. It was a tinfoil hat. It was the best one I've ever seen. I need to add that.
That's funny. Oh.
So your rate's higher than our company then, huh, Mike?
What's that?
Your rate's higher than we are.
Yeah, it's 95 Monday through Friday, pretty much 9 to 5. And then after hours or a week, and it's 150 per hour.
Yeah, it's... Florida's more competitive. I guess that's why he's got the prices where he's got them. But Sunday's higher because it's, you know, double time for the mechanics. So he's got to keep the pay with that. Did I do that or did you do that? I have like a background now.
Yeah, I was just looking at that.
I didn't even realize. I just clicked on the effects and it happened.
Yeah, if you click on them, it'll change them from one to the other.
Oh, okay.
And if you slide the little diamonds on the top of that, it will give you the glasses and the hat and all that as well.
All right.
Oh, there you go. I like that.
That's you.
Specifically him.
Get my birthday
right here in Alaska, dude. That's awesome. Whoa. Very interesting.
Got my monocle out like Mr. Peanut.
Where am I going?
You fading into the background there.
Yeah. All right, how do you get it out of there? Okay. Back in the middle. All right, my wife just got home. I got to say hi to her real quick, so... I'll be back in a few. Should I mute my sound?
Yeah, just mute your mic just in case. I mean, probably should be fine unless... Props sounds. I don't even know what this stuff does. Probably shouldn't do it.
Yeah, you can even put up your own business name and whatnot with and everything on it too, your logo and stuff like that. You have to go in there and set it up.
Yeah, mine's just probably my YouTube channel background picture. Those thumbnails are so small. It's such a good picture, too. Nobody probably realizes even what I'm doing in the picture. Can anybody tell what's going on in my YouTube picture? Just for fun. I don't even know if you can see it anywhere here. It's probably the most unsafe picture. I probably shouldn't even have it. But if you can't tell, I'm sitting on a compressor that's being hoisted by a crane, like the Miley Cyrus video where she's on the wrecking ball.
Oh, Lord.
Oh, God.
You can't really see it in the YouTube thumbnail, though. What was that?
Jesus.
Well, fellas, it is 10 o'clock. It's been an hour. I am going to stop the live broadcast of this, but the hangout will continue as it is right now. I just don't want to have to go edit a 4 or 5 hour video. So I'm going to go ahead and stop the live video, but the chat will keep on going so we can still chit-chat. And anybody that's watching the video on YouTube, the link is in the live chat that you can click on and come join us even after it stops. So until next Friday for our next hangout, thank you for dropping by, and don't forget to watch my live broadcast Monday through Thursday at 8 o'clock, somewhere between 8 and 8:30 is when I start them. Peace! Somebody